Great. Thank you, Scott. So coming from various repair options, which are demonstrated very well on this slide, I think replacement options also evolving pretty quickly and well. And we heard in previous session that repair and replacements in surgical therapy are achieved with one aim, and that is to eliminate TR. For replacement specifically, there are three approaches: superior vena cable, inferior vena cable, and transatrial. This is just a case example. I'm going to show you a case example from Colombia. This is a 92-year-old female patient. These are the typical tricuspid patients we get at present, who has some comorbidities, but essentially very elderly, but pretty active. And she has got patent grafts, and she has had some intervention done on the grafts before. Surprisingly, her LV function was reasonable, and again, RV function was also reasonable, which is quite important in this patient. She has got severe TR, and she has got minor disease in the other valves. So being 92 and a reop, obviously, we didn't want to do a surgery on this patient. So we looked at a couple of things, and one of the important things was the RV function was good, so we can try and eliminate TR rather than repair it with something and leave her with some TR behind. That was the logic behind this. The device which we used, and this is what we started nearly 1.5 years ago, that was the Navigate tricuspid device. Some of the important design features of this device, it's a relatively short device, which is quite important. There are some tines which are on the ventricular side, which engage with, go around or in between the chordae, and then that stabilizes the device. And then the atrial aspect, there is a small brim, which keeps the device in exactly in the AV groove. The delivery system is a pretty primitive delivery system, as it's a first generation device. It is fairly large in size as expected because the device size is quite big as well. Surprisingly, this device comes in various sizes. This device was initially designed for mitral, but has been applied now mainly in the tricuspid area. The delivery system was intended to be used through jugular venous approach, but there are some salient problems which come, which I'll highlight in the next two slides. As you can see that there is essentially only one bend in the delivery system. When you pull the delivery system to position the device, it can lead to some displacement of the device if you're doing it through the jugular axis. The other big problem in tricuspid is sizing. And we use the three mentors come up with the tricuspid algorithm, but in early days we used to use the mitral. The tricuspid annulus is ill-defined, so to speak, so getting exact sizing becomes sometimes difficult. We tend to measure it in systole as well as diastole, and then Becky, of course, helps us with the sizing with the 3DT done preoperatively. This patient had an average diameter varying from 46 millimeter to around 49 millimeters. This is just to show you, if you're going to do this through jugular vein, this is how the delivery system is going to sit through. But as you can imagine, when you pull the delivery system, when you have deployed the ventricular portion, and then you're pulling it up to the annulus, the tangent is actually in a completely wrong direction, and this can tilt the device in relation to the annulus. The real pull you want is in this direction. This is one of the main reasons, other than the size of the jugular vein, we decided that we should do this procedure transatrially so as to get the best coaxiality. Again, there were a couple of other things we wanted to plan. One is where to put the pacing wire, as we wanted to use pacing for deployment. We decided to put the pacing wire in the left ventricle. Over the period of time, we have gone away without pacing. So this device can be deployed without pacing as well. We chose a 48 millimeter device, which is 0% oversizing. CT planning was crucial. This was one of our first cases, so you can see that we used CT in terms of the exact purse string location because we wanted to use, we wanted to be perfectly coaxial. This is exactly what we're doing now. We also put a guide wire in the right coronary artery just to highlight the level of the annulus and whether it will provide us with a guide. That's the metal instrument which I'm poking, which was actually very well seen on the echo as well, to measure two things. Am I coaxial to the annulus? And the second is, what's the distance between the annulus and the intended purse string, which becomes pretty relevant. As you can see here in this particular patient, there's a confida wire in the left ventricle, which we use for pacing. This was the surgical access. We surgeons use this access very commonly for mini mitrals, mini tricuspid. This was, again, you can see in the fifth intercostal space, I had to retract the diaphragm down to get to that exact point of purse string, but this was fairly easy. Subsequently, we have stuck to this planning with very good results in most of the patients. Following that, you puncture and pass a guide wire, then it becomes a Seldinger technique. Then you insert the sheath, which is fairly big size. It's around 38 to 40 French sheath. Only 2 centimeters of the sheath is inside the right atrium. And following that, then the delivery catheter is inserted. As you can see, I'm holding the sheath in such a way that air doesn't enter the right atrium. The device somehow looks like this, and a fluoroscopy. The device is advanced, and from then on, essentially, it becomes echo-guided procedure. And fluoroscopy we use only once or twice when we inject the right coronary or use some feature such as a guide wire in the right coronary to get the accurate position. So you can see, for example, we are using the right coronary injection here. The ventricular side has started flaring. One has to remember that this is a very short device, so the flare can, you know, the ventricular flare, although it looks quite big here, when you deploy it, actually is going to get bigger than that. Again, on explain on echo, and I think Becky can comment on that later, we see the device very well. It's very important not to dive in the ventricle too much because the tine can get engaged into moderator band or something else, and then that, of course, becomes the biggest problem. As you can see here, majority of the device is now deployed. Then we pull some traction and then finally release the device by just simply unsheathing it. Remarkably, after first patient or two where we're a bit apprehensive about the positioning, I think we have got a good feel of it now. And you can see that once the tricuspid valve is deployed, it looks very good. And again, this is the picture which really impressed me in the first patient, absolutely no TR at all. We have subsequently done some cases with pacing leads as well. Post-procedural course is simple. You close the chest, put a drain, and the patient was discharged in a relatively short period. So around 26 cases have been done, and Becky has published this article as well. Not surprisingly, majority of the valve sizes we have used with 0% algorithm are 48 and 52 size. This is one of the Achilles heel of tricuspid replacement. All these patients who we see have actually annuli much more than even 52 millimeters, and that's when we rule these patients out of any trial at present from device point of view. Just to summarize very quickly, when deployed properly, it works well. One or two cases had some PV leak, but not very significant. And as we expected, this is a compassionate protocol. I think with better delivery system, second generation device, this will get better. Two other devices have now been used in tricuspid area. One is a transatrial intrepid, which was done in Colombia a few months ago. The advantage of this particular device with this form of delivery system is that it's recapturable. So if you are not in the ideal position, it can be recaptured. The second thing is it can be done with pacing leads. Our patient had two leads in the going through the annulus and the tricuspid valve. And the third thing in my mind is if you need pacing in these patients, you could probably go between the two gaps of the stents. Now, EVOC, one or two cases have been done now in Canada. It's not recapturable, but at the same time, advantage is that, again, I think positioning is a 28 French delivery system, so again, can be done transfemorally. So in future, I think we're going to see more of these devices which are designed and developed for mitral being more so applied in tricuspid. But the main problem, I think, is the size of these devices and its implications. Thank you.